To 6:33. Hey, let me share a few things with you as folks are still coming in. There's a lot of good things that are going on. Let's just start with this. Of course, tonight, looking forward to spending some time with the Lord. And one of my dear friends, Danny Petrucci, and his wife Christine are here. And Danny's going to be sharing some vision. Danny was with us almost since the inception all those years ago. He and his wife now live in Delaware, and I'm already giving him the props for when he speaks here before too long. But they were so instrumental in helping us lay a lot of the foundation. And what is really awesome, you all know we've been talking a lot about foundational things and getting back to the very core and building strong from the bottom up, inside out type of things. And Danny's going to be sharing some stuff about seasons. And so we know how God is just tying all that together. So we're looking forward to that in just a few moments. Brother Jake will be taking the kids back here in just a moment. You may pull me down just a little bit if you could, please. Sounds like I got some reverb in there, too. He'll be taking them back in a moment. Josh is out of town. And I think Tasha Cobbs or somebody like that will be leading us in worship here in a minute. I think. Tomorrow night, where's Laura at? Laura, what time tomorrow night? 6 o'clock right here, is that correct? Ladies meeting tomorrow night at 6 o'clock right here. Let's go ahead and thank God for our women. Guys, that's your opportunity to do that. So tomorrow night, 6 o'clock. And then also, the Center for Women's Ministries here in town, which Denise Barrett is part of, and of course helps lead and direct and do a lot of things there, on August the 14th, from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m., they're going to be having a conference, if you will, right up here at the Center on Main. Many of you know Lisa Smart. Many of you know her. I would know her as Lisa Golden Smart, Jack Golden and Regina's daughter. She'll be the guest speaker there. They're going to have a lot of different things going on there that day. That's on August 14th, starting at 9 a.m. Registration is from 9 to 9:15. At the end tonight, right outside here, Denise will be out here, and any information that you may need on that, I don't know if they're signing people up already. I don't know how that's going to work, but Denise will be taking care of that. So, August 8th, Life Sunday. I'm going to keep speaking that. Somebody say Life Sunday. Okay, what we're going to be doing that day, I want you to think about this, that if you had one opportunity to reach somebody for the kingdom with a sign, what would it say? Choose Jesus, choose life. Would it say, I am the way, the truth, the life? It may be something as simple as saying, it's time to come home. You've got to think about that person that's going to come around the square, because that's where all of us are going to be. That's going to be our church service, okay? And, of course, parents, we want you to really keep your kids close, but we want everybody there. We want the babies. We want everybody. We're going to believe for good weather. We're going to believe that, but we're going to be holding up our signs. We're going to be doing that. I want to encourage you that if you have an issue standing a very long time at all, we want to encourage you to bring a bag chair. I want to encourage you to do that. If you don't have one, Stephen will get you one. Oh, he's hiding back there, hitting you somewhere. So, anyway, we'll be doing that. We'll also have some of the pop-up tents set in different corridors. I've already spoke to the judge executive here, a county judge. And this is awesome. And I talked to Kevin. Kevin said, I'll be there. Can we thank God for people that will just simply say, I'll be there? Now, it's on him now to be there, you know. I've talked to the mayor. The mayor said, I'll be in church service. But he said, listen, we're going to be praying. He said, I think it's wonderful. I've talked to the sheriff and different ones. I got a call in to the city police. Chief David also, he's on vacation, I think, this week or something. But anyway, just wanted to let you know. Also, we've contacted the other pastors. Many of the pastors already, they're in town. We told them it's not mandated at all, but we would love for them to stand with us. This is not a Potter's Hope thing. This is a Jesus thing. Can somebody say amen? So when you think about that, I don't want you to think in your mind, hey, that's a good Sunday for me to go to the lake. Okay? Because I'm gonna start shaming you right now. But that's going to be a Sunday that, what about the person that's getting ready to come around the square? And she's a young mom and she just found out. What about a sign that says, choose life? That'll be the same time that we start promoting, we're already starting to promote it, but clear choices, okay? And many of you know what Clear Choices does, but you're going to see so much more of that. That day, what we'll have, what I expect to see, really trying to work out whether or not we can do the baby dedications and the charge to the parents before we go up there. We're still trying to work all the logistics out. Just want you to know that. Be in prayer. Really want clarity. But what we'll do is you come to the square. I guess it's going to be West Main. It's going to be East Main. We'll have that down there. We'll have a prayer tent down there. We'll have water down there. We'll have all of those things down there. Everybody here is going to get a Gospel of John. And it's going to be on you that day somewhere to give that Gospel of John away. And it's our hope, even though we don't want to stop traffic, we don't want to do those things, our goal will be to do that. But it's simply to get the word out and to really let God just use us. Let God use us. We're believing that souls will be changed that day. We don't know exactly how that's going to work, but we believe that we're living in a time right now where people need hope. And how many of you know we've got the greatest hope there is? Amen. We've got Jesus, boy. So I want you to be thinking about what you're going to have on your sign. What I can see happening the Wednesday night before that is we'll be making some signs. We'll also have some professionally made signs that I've already contacted them. We'll be doing that. Choose Life, different ones, different things. So that'll be part of that. So a lot of things going on. Tomorrow night, 6 o'clock right here, ladies. August 14th, please get with Denise Barrett right out here. Men that are here this morning, we will be having a men's breakfast, 7 a.m. 7 a.m. This Saturday morning. And we'll be doing that. We originally had planned to build a couple of ramps, to take the work crews, and to go out and build a couple of ramps with threat of rain. We wanted to clarify that with the people we were doing it and told them that we would postpone that, hopefully to the next Saturday. So, to all the men that are here, we're looking forward to seeing you. Stand with me today. How many of you love Jesus? Well, you got that part down. How many of you know Jesus loves you? See, boy, that's critical. That's life-changing right there. Going to do something a little bit different. As you cue up some music back there, Eric, if you could, just softly, I want you to pray for the one on your right hand first, okay? The one to your right. Heavenly Father, we adore you tonight. We're so thankful for all of your goodness and grace. And God, tonight, I'm praying for the one on my right. I lift him up to you. I just pray, God, that you would bless him abundantly, God, and that people could even see that favor isn't even fair. That, God, there's a release right now from the throne room upon those, God, that are hungry for you. And, God, right now to the one on my left, I pray, God, that you bless her in abundance. I pray today, God, that she would even see herself, God, as you see her. God, let us walk in power. Let us walk in your victory. We give you all the glory and we give you all the honor. And, Lord, tonight we want to magnify your name. We want to praise you. We want to thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Marty, will you come, please? You said you wanted to stand in the gap for somebody. Elders, come, please. I want to do this. I don't want to forget. If you'll come right here. Marty, stand in the gap. Right here. Elders, will you come? How many of y'all believe in the power of prayer? He's standing in the gap for his son-in-law, for Ronnie, and we believe in healing. If you want to come up and put a hand on somebody's back, you can. If you want to stretch your hand this way. Marty, standing in the gap. Heavenly Father, we adore you tonight. Marty is a point of contact. God, I know tonight you can heal. We need a miracle. But God, tonight we're not going to stop here. We're going to come to the throne room and agree that whatever we ask in the name of Jesus, you said you'd do it. Your word declares, is anything too hard for the Lord? So even tonight as we get started, we're going to expect a miracle. And God, that's the thing that we need to do. We need to spend more time expecting than we do trying to explain. God, you're the reason for the miracle. And God, tonight all over this house, we believe that your name is greater than diabetes, heart disease. God, COVID, anything else that is trying to steal life in the name of Jesus, we speak life. God, and declare your name and declare your word tonight that you said whatever I bind here on earth, that it'll be bound in heaven. And whatsoever we loose here will be loosed in heaven. Well, God, we can declare tonight that healing is being loosed in your name, Jesus. We love you, we praise you, and we give you all the glory. It's in your name we pray. Hallelujah. Can everybody say hallelujah? Can we just thank the Lord? If he's ever healed you, go ahead and give him some praise. No reason why we can't. All right, Eric, let's go ahead and worship together if we can. Thank you, my friend.
Yeah. darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Boy, you know what? There's a line in it. Jake, we're going to let you go ahead and take him youngins on back. Janika, we'll let you take him youngins on back. And we just want to ask tonight that you don't forget your kids when you leave, okay? Amen. You can be seated this evening. I like that song when that song says, "In his freedom, I am free." Boy, hallelujah. So thankful for that. And most every time, like we always do, let's thank God for all these youngins tonight, huh? All kinds of. Just all kinds of. So thankful. And I believe that line gets longer and longer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. God is so good. So tonight, guys, I've already said quite a bit about my buddy Danny. Danny was such a big part of the foundation here years ago as the Lord was laying on our heart about structure. And God has used he and Christine wherever that I know that he has appointed for them to be. They do come from some really good lineage. And when I mean that, talking about Christine's parents that are truly have been missionaries different parts of the world and truly are, boy, I'm talking about strong Bible-believing. And they have passed that mantle down to them or passing that down to them. But without saying any more, will y'all please make Danny feel welcome tonight as he comes. Come on, Danny.
For a minute. So, if you would, open your Bibles to Acts 17. Acts 17, I'm reading verses 24 through 28. I'll be sharing out the New King James Version. Verse 24. God who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of the heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made of hands, nor is he worshipped with man's hands as though he's needed anything, since he gives all life, breath, and all things. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth and has determined their pre-appointed times and their boundaries of dwellings, so that they will seek the Lord in hope that they might grope for him, though he is not very far from one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as some of the poets have said, for we are his offspring. If you would, turn to somebody by you, turn to your neighbor and say, what time is it? What time is it? I hope by the end of the night we all know what time it is. All right. Thank you, Jesus. So when you're at the right place and you're in the right times, you can grope for him and find his perfect will for our lives. We are at the right place, and this is the right time. So we're here for such a time as this. Before we were born, God created his plans for us. He provided them. He established his purpose before we were created and put it in writing. Now that word purpose is the word prethesis. Pre means before, and thesis is that writing. He's put it all in writing before time began. We're in the year 2021. It's also the Hebrew calendar, 5781. And that year is, it says, the year of the Father's voice. New things emerge through unusual or new partnerships. Creative powers are evident. Strong prophetic and apostolic voices across our kingdom spring forth. And revelations are received. New beginnings, new eras starts now. Not despising the small thing, dark seems to counter the light, but will not prevail. Time and mergers and acquisitions will occur. Now we're getting ready to move into 5782, 2022. And I'm looking around for my buddy Mike Blair, and he would be able to explain this a little better, but I believe it's, I want to say September 7th or September 8th, but it's right in that range. And as we're moving into that new year, it says, this is the year of the voice of the Son. Boundaries start to be drawn as space is made with new things birthed. New houses, new enterprises start to take shape. Governmental and ruling houses see great change as old things fall away and new things emerge. Now, Ecclesiastes, it tells us that God's a God of timing. There are appointed times and place for everything. It says there is a time for everything under the sun, everything under heaven. Now the sons of Issachar, one of the tribes of Israel, they were able to discern the times. There were men who understood the times, and they were able to tell them what to do. We need to understand the timings and the seasons that we are in, that God ordains us to live our lives, our ministries, our cities, and our nation. Now, these are all important prerequisites to knowing what to do. Now, in 2 Timothy 4:2, it says, be instant in season and in out of season. Now, what he's telling us is we need to be ready no matter what the timing is, whether it's the perfect timing or not. Now, there are three verses in Isaiah that speak of God's change into new seasons. Isaiah 48, and again, everything's out of the New King James Version. It says, you have heard, see all things, and will you not declare it? I have made you hear new things from this time, even hidden them from you, and you did not know them. Isaiah 43:19. Behold, I will do a new thing. It shall spring forth. You shall not know it. I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Isaiah 42:9 says, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declare before they spring forth. I will tell you of them. I just believe we're in that time and season where God's getting ready to move and do a lot of things right now. Now, the Bible speaks not only of a chronos time, which refers to the general time or the chronological time. It also speaks to a kairos time, which is the right time, the opportune time or strategic time, a now time. But it also talks about a plethora or a fullness of time. Now, Galatians 4:4 reads, but when the fullness of time has came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Now, the word fullness indicates fully completing or finishing something, whereas kairos indicates an opportunity to perform a task or to produce fruit. Plural means that it has been accomplished. Now, this could be linked to the process of birthing forth a child. After conception, a woman goes through all three timing, chronos, kairos, and plura. For 9 months, she faithfully endures challenging but important developmental stage of chronos. Much is happening in the hidden place of the womb, but she cannot yet fully hold or enjoy the fruit that she knows is coming. She then moves into the kairos stage of labor and delivery. She hasn't come to the fullness, but it's near. This kairos time is very difficult and dangerous, however. Opportunity doesn't guarantee success. Opportunity doesn't guarantee success. There will be much work, pain, and pushing if the fullness stage of birth is to be reached. Finally, the woman goes from the kairos season into the plura stage of fullness. The baby is born. It is always worth the pain and process when this occurs. Now, spiritual births are also difficult and dangerous. But unlike a woman in labor, however, we can give up during these strategic times. And we can stop the delivery process. Are you struggling to get to the next stage? Don't give up. Your struggles won't be wasted. And they may even be necessary. And the key is not to quit. The disciples went through all three timings as well, chronos, kairos, and plura. First, they went through three intense years with Jesus. Then kairos, the cross, the resurrection, the ascension. He was gone. They wanted to quit. Some even considered going back to their old occupations. Peter said, I'm going fishing. They were very close to the fullness of their time. But like many of us, they came very close to losing the baby in the transition between kairos and plura. Finally, a few days later, Pentecost, they were full of, where they proceeded to turn the world upside down. Plura, fullness had come. Aspects in the body. Kingdom authority and power is found in the commission. Discovering God's original commission and purpose for mankind can help to fortify our resolve for a life-changing, for a life of history-changing significance. You know, Adam and Eve were placed in a garden with a mission. He said, be fruitful, multiply, fill it, and subdue it. And God's intention was that they had more children that also lived under his rule. They would be extending the boundaries of his garden, his government, through the simplicity of their devotion to him. The greater number of people in a right relationship to God, the greater the impact of their leadership. The process was to continue until the earth was covered with the glorious rule of God through man. Now, these two essential components to the body of Christ, we have the relational, the family aspects of the church. That's the Greek word oikos. And we have our legislative, God-given governing authority as believers. That's the Greek word ekklesia. Now, unfortunately, we've loved each other through the charismatic movement, and we lost America because we didn't understand that we are an ecclesia, called to disciple a nation. While we were getting people saved, the world around us was discipling America. They took over our government, our education, our business, our media, arts and entertainment, and family. Excuse me. There's no such thing as secular employment for a believer. Let me say that again. There's no such thing as secular employment for a believer. Once you're born again, everything is about us is redeamed for kingdom purposes. Amen. It is all spiritual. It is either a legitimate kingdom or kingdom expression, or we shouldn't be involved at all. Every believer is in full-time ministry. Only few have pulpits and sanctuaries. The rest have their pulpit in their area of expertise and the favor in the world system. Be sure to only preach the good news. And when necessary, use words. The call of God is important, not because of the title it carries or doesn't carry. An assignment to be in the business is just as valuable in the kingdom as a call to be an evangelist. The privilege to be a stay-at-home wife or mother is as equal importance as being a missionary. Prophetic ministry shouldn't be focused on the sins of the world. And I'm reminded, you know, I shouldn't be trying to take the sliver out of their eye when I got a log in my own. It takes very little discernment to find the dirt in people's lives. Prophetic in its truest form is designed to find the gold in people's lives and to bring it to the surface. See, the world knows they're lost. They know they're dying. They're looking for something. They already know that. It's our job to let them know they're loved. Seven mountains are spears in every society. Now, these are the spears of the government, education, religion, business, media, arts and entertainment, and family. Now, Christians are to bring the kingdom of God down into the spear that they have influence on. When we think the church mountain is the only spiritual mountain, we form a great divide between church and culture. The shocking truth is that every mountain is a spiritual mountain. And if the church fails to occupy these high places with teaching the kingdom, the enemy will build strongholds of deception in these seven areas. God fully intends there to be a fulfillment of his word. The goal isn't to pull a convert out of the world into church. It is to raise up disciples that go into the world. Amen. I'm going to say that again. Amen. The goal isn't to pull a convert out of the world into the church. It's to raise up disciples that go out into the world. So we are called to go into and invade every system with an influence that liberates that system to its fullest potential. I'm getting ready to say something here. It's a little bit harsh. Probably going to be hard to hear, but please stay with me. I'm going somewhere. The sad reality of the modern day church is failing this nation. It is estimated that more than 150,000 people walk out of church each week and never return. That's a week. That's 8 million people a year that walk out the door into an uncertain eternity. Christianity in America is in a rapid state of decline. The recent study, it shrank by 12% in just the last 10 years. That's the largest drop ever recorded in this nation's history. The number of children denied the right to life has reached 63 million and rising. As we've sat back and watched the rise of radical Islam in our day, which has caused tens of thousands to be martyred around the world. February 15th, 2015, 21 from an Egyptian church were martyred, and their murders were videotaped and broadcast around the world to see. Each of them was given an opportunity and a chance to renounce Christ and accept Muhammad as their prophet. Now, it was discovered after the fact that one of these 21 men wasn't even a follower of Jesus. He was a refugee from the nation of Chad, captured by the terrorists. As he knelt there in the sand watching these Christians give their life to Christ, he was moved. When it came his turn to denounce Christ or lose his life, he boldly responded, "Their God is my God. Their God is my God." He chose to give up his life for the cause of Christ. What about us? We see the destruction of the God-ordained family. Today, homosexuals fight harder for marriage than the church does. It's time for us as the church to take responsibility for how bad we have let things get, how it's happening. It's time for the church to change its mindset to what does the King want, regional in vision and mission, and not just congregational in vision. Let me say that again. It's time for the church to change its mindset to what does the King want, regional in vision and mission, and not just congregational. It's all about the King and His kingdom and extending His kingdom rule to impact the region which we live in. God's intent is that all government at every level, starting at the home all the way to the nation, flows from Him and is based on His principles. Okay, Isaiah 33:22 states that God is our lawgiver, our judge, and our king. Our government, with its three branches, were formed on these, with this verse in mind. Our founders intended for America's government to function under God's authority. So, to separate government from God is to, by default, hand over the rule to Satan. He then influences humans to pervert God's intent, using government to promote personal, selfish agendas, to oppress and control. These evils to government is what the spirit of religion is to a relationship with God. Both are perversions of what He desired and established in Genesis. Relationship with a family and a spirit-led management and government of creation. Governmental authority, ecclesia. Matthew 16:18-19. "And I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." In the disciples' day, the paradigm of the ecclesia, the church, was very different than our contemporary notions. In disciples' culture, an ecclesia was an assembly of people assigned to govern the affairs of the city, the state, or that nation. In essence, they were a parliament or a congress. To the Romans, it was an assembly of people who sent into a conquered region to govern, but also to alter it and become like Rome. They infiltrated government, language, social culture, schools, etc., and to the people talked, thought, and acted like Romans. In other words, they brought their culture and their ideas of the kingdom of Rome and assigned it to their region. And that's exactly what we're supposed to be doing with the kingdom of God. When Jesus said he would build his church, his ecclesia, he was speaking of a body of people who would legislate spiritually for him, extending his kingdom government and influence on the earth. He follows with this declaration by saying that he would give his ecclesia the keys, which, just as in Isaiah 22:22, represents spiritual authority. In Isaiah 22:22, the keys close and open spiritual doors, allowing and disallowing, access and activity. In Matthew 16, Christ Church also has keys to bind, to loose, to lock, unlock, allow, forbid the gates of governmental decisions of hell and release the governmental decisions of heaven. So when Jesus says, I'm going to build my church, my ecclesia, he wasn't talking about a building. He wasn't talking about a 501c3 or a congregation. The word means legislator. It's the governmental arm of the kingdom of God giving the authority to bind or loose. Now, as our mindsets shift to expanding the kingdom, we need to become more fivefold in our thinking. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Because these gifts are not just positions. It's not a hierarchy. They're not titles. They are identifying function. And they are gifts. And if we take the time to carefully read that passage in Ephesians 4, what Jesus did is he divided his five anointings. The word Christ means anointed one. So he broke himself into five gifts or anointings, and he gave them to the church as gifts so the church would reveal and represent him to the earth. So we need all five gifts working together for Christ to reign in this region. Job 22:28. You shall also decree a thing, and it will be established for you, and light will shine your ways. So when you tell God, so when God tells us what he wants through his word, the Bible, and prophetic inspiration, and we say what he says, I'll create those words. When it comes out of our mouth, it does something to this atmosphere. When you decree what God says about the atmosphere, your house will change. When you decree what God says out loud about you, your mind will change. I am the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. Greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. I'm the head, not the tail. I'm above, not beneath. It goes on and on and on. I mean, we could stay here all night just in the Bible about what he says about us, and it changes us. I am the temple of the Most High God. Thank you, Jesus. Ephesians 6, we are told to take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. However, it's not a sword to the devil until we say what it says. Let me say that again. It's not a sword to the devil until we say what it says. Matthew 18, chapter 18, verses 18 and 19 says, assuredly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Verse 19, again I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. If two of you agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done by their Father in heaven. Can I get two people to agree with me today that we need things to change here? Amen. We need his kingdom to come? Amen. And it says when we're two of us are gathered, it's granted to us by his Father in heaven. Amen. In Acts 2, the first New Testament Pentecost was about birthing the ecclesia, the kingdom of God, and the government with Christ's heirs. It was about a great move of God, abundant harvest, the fivefold ministry, about activating the saints to do their part. Now we are entering into a mega birthing season. There are things that he has impregnated into his kingdom that have now come to calving season. They are due. We're getting ready to start the third great awakening, or the kingdom age, where the king and his kingdom come together. In Luke 19:13, it says we're supposed to occupy till he comes. Amen. So it's not a time for this church to be passive or quiet. It's a time for us to get back to our original mandate. Now, we just recently celebrated the 4th of July, our Independence Day. So as we do, let's remember in 1607, after landing at Cape Henry, Robert Hunt planted a cross on the beach and declared, we do hereby dedicate this land and ourselves to reach the people within these shores with the gospel of Jesus Christ and to raise up godly generations after us with these generations to take the kingdom of God to all the earth. May this covenant of declaration remain to all generations, as long as the earth remains and this land, be evangelists to the world. May all who see this cross remember what we have done here. And may those who come here inhabit, join in with this covenant that this most noble work of the Holy Scriptures be fulfilled. America's a godly nation formed on godly principles. The thought of shaping the future is powerful. But past history is also very important. Karl Marx said, if I can steal their history, I can steal their country. Let me say that again. Karl Marx said, if I can steal their history, I can steal their country. I'm thinking right now, kind of sounds like what's going on right now. Roots are essential and powerful. Foundations are critical. Before facing Goliath, David asked a question. Is there not a cause? Interestingly, the Hebrew word for cause is also the word history. Therefore, David might have been asking his brother and fellow Israelites, is there not a history? When David said, what would he meant by what he said such a question? Perhaps he was asking, don't we have a history worth believing and fighting for? Or thinking of his fellow Israelites, their unbelief, maybe David was asserting, is there not a history of faithfulness from God to bring enough confidence to face the giant? What about Abraham and the promises he made to God, made to him? Did God not come through with Isaac in the land? What about Exodus and all the miracles? Come on, guys. Isn't there enough of history with God to bring the needed courage to face that giant? We have history on our side. That's what David was saying. In addition, he may have been referencing Israel's covenantal history. The fact that they were in a covenant with God meant that he would fight for them. Their enemies were his enemies. It also, when you're in a covenant with God, his resources were their resources. With God on their side, they couldn't fail. A history with God is powerful. What about us as Christians today facing our spiritual giants in the land? Do we have history on our side? Yes. Scream the pilgrims, the founding fathers, and the early settlers. Knowing the truth of what Mark stated when he spoke of this country's history, there is an anti-God forces today that is trying to rewrite America's history. But we have a godly inheritance that cannot and will not be denied. Amen. Cannot and will not be denied. Jesus. Examples abound. The founding fathers of America declared their independence from England. They also acknowledged their dependence on God. Very aware that he was the author of their existence. They stated their reliance of God to provide wisdom and leadership necessary to create and maintain a new nation. The Declaration of Independence has four clear references of God. It speaks of him as a lawmaker, a creator, a judge, and protector. It concludes with these words, and for the support of this declaration with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge each of our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. And there's a lot that goes into that. If you go back and look at the history, most all of them gave their lives. After signing the declaration, some wept. Others, like Witherspoon, bowed their heads in prayer. Samuel Adams rose and stated, we have this day restored our sovereign, to whom alone men ought to be obedient. He reigns from heaven, and from the rising and setting of the sun, may his kingdom come. The Liberty Bell rang on that day of America's first birth, got its name from a Bible verse inscribed on it. Yes, the Liberty Bell contains scripture. Proclaim liberty throughout the land and all the inhabitants thereof. Leviticus 25:10. Now this verse was taken from the description of the year of Jubilee, which was a prophetic picture of Christ, our Jubilee, who forgave our sins and freed us from spiritual slavery. Now just to make sure you get the connection, our nation's birth was announced under a biblical decree. Christ is our liberator and savior. Amen. We too can look back at what God has done, not just in biblical history, but our own history as well. Our greatest days aren't behind us, they're just ahead of us. The stories of revival are important. They are part of our shared history. And they are the reason why we are here today. Now, it isn't about trying to go back and live in the past. It's about reclaiming those fires of those who have gone before us and igniting afresh ones in the present as we continue blazing a trail into the future. God is looking for ones who are willing to step and follow in the footsteps of great men and women who preceded us. He is looking for some Elijahs, sons and daughters of God, who will pick up the mantles of departed generals and move forward to the next great awakening. Psalm 77, 11 and 12 says, I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I remember your wonders of old. I will meditate on your work and talk of your deeds. So go ahead, look back, and remember the wonders of the Lord. Excuse me. The Cane Ridge Revival, Cane Ridge, Kentucky. 1801, Barton Stone said, the effects of this through the country were like a fire in dry stubble driven by a strong wind. All felt its influence, more or less. The whole country appeared to be in motion to this place. And multitudes of all denominations attended. Let me say that again. And multitudes of all denominations attended. All seemed heartily to invite to unite in the work and in Christian love. Party spirit abashed, shrunk away. To give a true description of the meeting cannot be done. It would border on marvelous. It continued for 5 days and nights without ceasing. Many, very many through eternity remember it with thanksgiving and praise. Now, the Cane Ridge Revival marks a pivotal point in the history of our nation. The sins of the land continue to pile up. America has lost her way and forgotten why she was founded. A battle is raging for the soul of this nation. Just like it did before Cane Ridge, America again has moved from her godly principles on which you were founded. Now, in my brief study of revivals, all of them have at least two key points. People moved away from their godly principles, and a bunch of people from different denominations were hungry and came together as one. And why is that such a big deal? You know, right now there's 44,000 Christian denominations worldwide, 44,000, and over 200 in America alone. And unfortunately, we all can't get along with it. There was a great example, Appalachian Dawn happened in Manchester, and I'm not going to go there, but just example of them coming together. And that's why I'm so excited about Brother Wayne talking about August 8th, because when you can truly invite those other pastors, and when we can truly come together as one, in one accord, one mind, man, ain't nothing what he can't do. I'm excited. If I can work out my schedule, I'm going to be here. We desperately need another move of God. So where are those who would stand between heaven and earth and contend for mercy upon our land? Where is the church in this hour? When she's needed the most. It is time to wake up from our slumber and pray through the night, calling out, Lord, do it again like Cane Ridge. Revelation 5:8 says, and now he has taken the scroll of the four living creatures and the 24 elders and fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp of golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Revelation 8, 3 and 5 says, Then another angel, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar. He was giving much incense, that he should offer it for the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand. Then the angel took the censer, filled it with the fire of the altar, and threw it to earth. And there were noises, thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. The fire from the altar is the power of God released from heaven to change earth. As our prayers are lifted up to God, filled until they reach that point, the bowls are tipped over, and God's power and his provision showers the earth. So when you pray, you're filling up prayer bowls in heaven. It's God's, and in God's perfect timing, your prayers are mixed with the fire of God, his power, and cast back down to earth to change your situation. And it doesn't even matter if you don't feel like anything's happening in the natural world. Because when you pray, you're filling up your prayer bowls in the spirit realm. And when they are full, they're going to till and pour, and your prayers will be answered. As I'm moving into my closing, we have moved into a birthing stage. This is a now time. Now is a time. Here is the place. We are here for such a time as this to pray, decree, and agree what God has said. So, Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, thanking you for the decrees and declarations that were given by Yoder, Pierce, and Sheets according to your heart during the 50-state tour. We thank you that each and every one of these is coming to fruition in Kentucky. Father, according to your word, Ezekiel 12:28, you said, "Therefore, say to them, thus says the Lord God, none of my words will be postponed anymore. But the word which I speak out of my mouth is done, says the Lord of God." So we decree according to your word, no more delay. We say to the Ecclesia of Kentucky, united we stand, divided we fall. We say to the Ecclesia of Kentucky, the trumpet is sounded. It's time to run with the horses. Father, we thank you for the warring spirit arising from Kentucky and speaking to the entire nation. We thank you for the loosing of the horses, the runners and the riders that will run and ride through this nation once again, breaking out the first fruit state for revival. We thank you for the defeat. We thank you that divisions of past have come and been redeemed by giving Kentucky a first fruit anointing to set course for emancipation, freedom from legal, social, and political restrictions to our nation. We thank you that Lexington has released the war horses across the nation, and we're getting ready for war. We thank you, your breath, oh God, is cleansing physical diseases in the lungs. We thank you for the miraculous healing of cancer in this state. We thank you that a new order is rising up in this state, causing both the land and the church to flourish. We thank you for the mongoose anointing that's eating that serpent that held back revival. Father, you said, do not say next year or the following, for now you are swallowing up the serpent for this state. We thank you for the mantle of deliverance breaking out of the state, causing freedom to manifest in this entire nation. We thank you for the dismantling of ancient thrones, resulting in unlocking the future of Kentucky. We thank you for the supernatural confessions arising from the government in Kentucky. As men attempt to change righteous laws, the outcry and resistance from Kentucky has caused a remnant for this state to rise up to be in agreement with Kentucky. We thank you that the governmental anointing on this state is carried to Washington, D.C. We declare this state is from Kentucky to D.C. We thank you for the government anointing on this state. We thank you that Kentucky is an upper room. It's 120 counties, excuse me. We thank you that the worship exposing hidden things, causing the enemy to lose his hold, resulting in a dramatic change in the atmosphere. This is a dimension will cause thousands to come into worship. We thank you that the seer anointing has been loosed in Kentucky along with a great revelation. We thank you that the supernatural release through the strength to move to a new sound that causes nations to come into conflict. But as you said, the bride shall arise and they shall call forth freedom. We thank you that the new level, there's a new level of spirit and of wisdom and revelation bringing a higher level of prophetic anointing. We receive the watchman's charge according to Ezekiel 33:3. We thank you that as we move into the new dimension, we will be known as a hearing state. We thank you that the discerning of your spirits is released to your ecclesia, resulting in a strong, strong deliverance anointing with a strong, strong, strong spirit of deliverance. Jesus. We thank you that the mantles of war and worship, unlike anything ever seen before, a pleasant war because it's born out of worship, creating a great awakening. We thank you for the spirit of revelation resulting in divine strategies released that will gain great victories. We thank you that your ecclesia is invading the mountain of education, doing whatever you say do. Signs, wonders will be released in the universities, schools, organizations, elementary schools, and daycares. We thank you that we thank you for working together with your ecclesia, the one with wisdom and the one with revelation. For according to your word, Father, none moving until both are released. We thank you your ecclesia will experience things that it's never seen before because you, Lord, have laid siege to the state to take it back from what the enemy has stolen. We thank you that you are coming with fire because the fire of revival has begun to burn. We thank you that the ecclesia has learned to hear the sound of God, and that we will both find and go through the gate of revelation. We thank you that you will hear the sound of the rain. This nation has shifted. We thank you that the sounds of war, waters, winds, and thunder, and sounds of heaven have been released over this state and over this nation. Eric, if you could play that.
They heard a sound in Jesus' day, but they couldn't identify the sound. They missed it. They even heard the sound of John the Baptist. They heard the voice crying out, but they couldn't get it. You must hear the sound of the Spirit. You must hear the voice of God saying, come to me. You must hear him. You must hear the sound of heaven drawing you. You must hear the sound of his presence. You've got to get to that place where nothing matters but the voice, the sound. You must get there. It must drown out all else in your life. It must, all the cares, all of your other desires, all of your passions, everything else has to be brought down to a level where the loudest thing you hear is his voice saying, come, come, come. As you bring forth the sound of heaven, the Lord says, I will begin to fill the atmosphere. And it will be not what you say, it will be who you are. It will be who you are. It will be who you are. You will no longer wonder what it means not to be able to minister or move because of the weighty presence. You will know my weighty presence, he says. You will know my glory. You must ask him to come. You must create an atmosphere for his Spirit. You must give him worth. You must value him above your next breath. You must ask him to come. You must cry out until the sound of heaven reaches earth. You must cry out until your voices are one with his. You must cry. You must cry. You must cry out for it.
Say your kingdom come, your will be done. Holy Spirit, have your way here tonight. I don't know whether to do an altar call or to have you, because I wouldn't. Just, if you're here today and you don't know about my Jesus, now's the time. Come on up.
Hope those of you will tonight. You can agree. Can we thank God?
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you our Christ. What a beautiful name.
Can we do this tonight as you're still worshiping? We'll make a big circle. Stephen, if we could, we'll go down that line right there where you are. Luke, if you'll go down to the end and cover it, let's make a big circle in here. Let's make a big circle. Let's agree together.
What a beautiful name it is.
Brother Billy, if you'll go right there, we'll go down that lane right there where you're at. Absolutely down there. We'll swing back. Brother Roger, if you'll go right there in front of the black thing. Denise, that's right. Go right behind the seats there. There you go. Still an attitude of prayer.
So Jesus, you brought heaven down.
If you don't want to hold the next hand to you, that's fine. But if you feel comfortable doing that, let's gather together. How many of you believe that America needs revival? How many of you are willing to pray right now together, all of us in one mind and one accord? Let's pray for revival in this nation. Let it begin right here within all of us. Let's pray together. Brother Eric, you could turn that up a little bit if you'd like.